I fall in love, it will be forever, or I'll never fall in love. In a restless world like this is, love has ended before it's begun, and too many.
I needed everyone to be on the ball, you know. I needed everyone to be quick. I needed everyone to I just couldn't mess around with that, you know. But they were prepared for it. I drilled them for at least maybe 4 or 5 weeks straight. We sang the two songs in and out from beginning to end of the rehearsals. So after that, we, you know, I had thought, well, let's travel, let's do different countries. So we've been to New York, we've been to France, Germany, Italy, Poland, and quite a lot of European countries. And we were planning on a trip for this year to Japan. But we'll do that as soon as the air is clear.
Of
we need to continue to stay alert.
Definitely. Amazing. That is great. That's great. I'm going to hand over to Micah now, who will continue the rest of the questions.
Yeah, what I can say is wow so far. But what I'd like to firstly ask you is about Manchester Inspirational Voices. You have an album called Give Us Peace.
Yeah.
And the production on that album was just brilliant. The vocals were just brilliant. You believed every word your choir sang.
Mm.
So I wanted to ask, what went into you picking those songs? And why did you choose them? Because they're so relevant, especially in this coronavirus period.
Mm.
Into your song, Hallelujah. And when I wrote that video, my granduncle had just died of coronavirus.
Oh, wow.
But when I produced that, I literally believed every word. Wow. It was giving me so much comfort.
Wow. That's amazing to hear. Goodness. Yeah. Wow. Well, what led me to choose the songs that we sang on the album? We'd been singing them for a whole year.
Mm.
Previous. So in 2018, we've been singing all those songs from the beginning of the year.
Mm-hmm.
I informed the choir that we would be doing an album in that year, and those were the songs. 2017, we were doing a lot of those songs as well. And so there were two people in the choir who wrote songs. That was Hallelujah. That was written by my assistant choir director, Brenda McGoy, and Michael Troop. Throop, who wrote Awake. Now, Michael Throop wrote that song Awake because his son was in intensive care for quite some time, and he sat by his son's bedtime just humming this tune. So he gave me the melody and the lyrics of the song, and it was just, you know, just a complete skeleton version of it. And I sat with our MD James and asked him, you know, if he could throw some chords on this melody, and we just began to work together on that, and so the song Awake became something new, and Mike played the rehearsal of the song to his son, and sooner or later his son, you know, came out of a coma. So I'm thinking to myself, this song isn't just any old song that you just, you know, and it wasn't written by just a choir member. It was written by someone who believed in his son awakening, and we as a choir were right behind him and his wife and his family, you know. So that song, I'm glad the song's on the album because it will always remind us all of Mike and his son. Hallelujah, Brenda wrote that a couple of years ago, and we recorded it. The choir loved it. We sang it in Poland. We sang it everywhere, you know. We sang it in our Christmas concert. Yeah, it's a such a moving and uplifting song as well. It's quite a victorious song when you really think about it, you know. Count on Me. I started to teach that choir years ago, but it came back because there were, at the time, there were quite a few people in the choir who were going through lots of difficulties, and but I didn't know they were going through these difficulties at all. I hadn't a clue. I knew people going through issues, you know, had issues and stuff, but I didn't know the extent that it was at. And but when you heard drips and drabs of different stories, oh, so-and-so is going to visit so-and-so, and this group of people are having like a little dinner party there, and I'm thinking, this is really cool. I didn't feel I needed to be there. I didn't feel I needed to know about it, but to hear that choir members were meeting up and supporting each other in all these different circumstances blew me right away, you know. And but it didn't, you know, again, nothing goes to my head. I was just grateful that I was able to move forward with a vision that I had, but didn't know how it was going to work. But and I didn't need to know how it was going to work. I just knew that I had something to do. Yeah. On with it without asking anybody else. My admin and the team, they were like, if you need any help, you know, I'll be happy to help. We did our concert at the Bridgewater Hall for the first time in 2017. Bridgewater Hall is like your Barbican type of thing. Yeah. And I used to walk past that place and thought, you know, oh, I'd never be able to, you know, do a show in there. But then I changed that story. I thought, well, one day we will have a show in there. No, because it's not, it's right on the corner of, you know, of where we are, of where I live. And I thought, there's no way this building could be here and we can't get access to it. So members in my choir, they were like, I'm happy to help. You know, I thought, cool. We went to a meeting with at Bridgewater Hall. I kept silent. Wayne's there, Wayne does this, Wayne does that, and da-da-da-da. We said, I looked on your ethos and yada 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 yada, you know, and I was like, so I had my good friend Nigel, who's a lawyer, and I had Sue, who works for ITV. So they were the ones who were like, well, why are you going to wait 5 years to go to get to Bridgewater? Oh, why don't we do that this year? We can do it now. I'm like, cool. That's all I needed to hear.
Wow.
We're in Bridgewater Hall, we did it for the second time last year, and they love when we come there, you know. It was a full house, and we had 130, 40 something people on the platform, including the session orchestra and our band and choir. Amazing. So I'm not afraid to go forward to big things. They're too big to miss. And that came from a message, a preacher that I heard back in Brighton Conference Center back in the day, when he was talking about David and Goliath. And all the Philistines, they were like, you know, yes, we're going to take this, you know, take down the Israelites and blah, blah, blah. And you had little David, you know, with his sling. And whilst everyone else was scared of Goliath, little David was like, well, he's too big to miss. I could miss that.
Oh, wow. So
that's where I took that vision from. Things that seem really massive and challenging and scary, they're too big opportunities to miss. So I thought, face the fear and do it anyway, as they say.
I'd also like to ask, because your choir, it has a strong sense of community. Whenever I hear them sing, I just hear this community.
Mm.
I think that the sense of community is what a lot of young men, they lack.
Yeah.
Sense of community.
Mm.
So being somebody who's been involved in developing people, how do you think the church can provide young men with the opportunity to find their identity in the right things?
Mm. I do feel that if we're looking at it from a church perspective, it will take a visionary to be able to make each individual young male feel safe, feel loved and understood. And they all aren't going to be easy. I used to work for Barnardo's charity, working with 16 to 21 year olds. And I had a lot of angry young men and angry young women And they always used to give me the angry people because they felt, well, I had the persona to kind of calm them down and get something good out of them. And I thought to myself, that was just so unfair. But then I embraced it, you know. I thought, well, if you feel that I have that ability to work with someone who's really irate, then I'll work with them, you know, because they're still human beings and it's not their fault that they're in the system. Yeah. So it took a lot of understanding and it took a lot of letting go of old traditions and culture and just stripping it down to its bare minimum. So you see the young person, you see the young person's mind, and you're able to just be open and real with that young person as well. If it's no, it's no. I'm going to scratch your car up. Fine. It's a material thing. Scratch it up. Do you know what I mean? I'm going to come to your house. I'm like, well, yeah, come to my house, even though you don't know where I live, but yeah, cool. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. So threaten you and they'll say all these things, but I'm not saying that every young man or every young woman is like that, but looking at how the church can be very influential in that, I think they're gonna have to think outside of the box. My audience for my choir concerts are not the church. Mm-hmm. So you have to think differently because folks don't know church mentality, and especially the predominant black church that I was brought up in, which I don't dumb down at all. I love the fact that I was brought up in a predominantly black church. That's my history. Love it. Would I change anything back then? No. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't change anything. But I can change some things now. Yeah. No, because I'm not in it as much now, you know? So, and that's why the choir is there. That's why the choir is the way they are. So I would say, whoever is leading a group of young men would really need to think out of the box and get them to do things that they don't want to do, because that's where you're going to find a lot of the answers.
Yeah.
You know, I wasn't really a mountain climber or, you know, walking for hiking in the hills and stuff. I mean, even though I love the hills, you know, it just wasn't me. But then members of my choir, even like my friend JP Cooper, Toby Wharton, Curtis, you know, all these young men that were in the choir, they were like, oh, we're going to go camping. Why don't you come with us? I'm like, no. And then I thought to myself, do you know what? Yeah, I'll come and hang out. We're like that. It bonded us so well, you know. And Toby and JP, they weren't Christians at the time, you know. So Toby then got baptized, JP got married, Curtis got married, you know, and just seeing how I was around those young men, and the same thing even when I was at university, you know, all the young guys, they were just like, well, how come you get to do all of this? And there you were influencing all these young guys around you, you know. A young person I used to work with at Barnardo's, still in touch with him now, you know. So I do think it takes a lot of being open, being non-judgmental, sacrificing a little bit of time, sacrificing a little bit of thought to their vulnerabilities, and finding ways to enable rather than disable. And that comes through the things that you say and the things that you do, the places that you ask them to follow you. You know, if you, a lot of the young guys, they would often come with me either to concerts, or if I'm invited to another country, I would ask the clients, you know, I've got another young man who's very interested in choir directing and so on. Do you have enough money in the budget to cover his costs and so on, you know? So things like that, and they'd come along. Some folks that are in the choir, that were in the choir, have moved down to London and are doing some great stuff. So, you know, in answer to your question, I've not answered it already. Yeah, it just takes a lot of openness. Just be open with these young guys, listen to them, and we don't have to say yes to everything that they suggest, but we can add to some of their suggestions or take some things away from some of their suggestions to make it a bit more of a firm foundation for them, and more of a coming together of themselves. They can impact themselves, and if they see you do it, then they'll want to do it, you know. But yeah, being open, being honest, and gaining that trust from them, like any relationship, building a good sense of trust. There's so much that, I mean, what you guys are doing is superb. Even things like this, you know, even if it's one young man that would see this, not just see me, but see that you're both putting something like this together, excuse me, they'd want to be a part of that, you know? Or even if they were sat in a room with you, all right, I want you to come with me, I just want you to watch how I do this, you know? Yeah, but I don't really want it. I'm like, well, just come for about 10 minutes, you know? Then they get to meet somebody, you know, who they've never met. They get to hear about someone else's story. And then before they leave, they'll be like, oh, that was all right, like, you know, that was really good. Yeah, I really enjoyed that. Do you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So introducing them to new things. My young people used to come to our choir practice. Yeah. I was told I can't bring my young people, my Barnardo's young people, to my choir practice. And I thought, okay, well, thanks for letting me know. Yeah. They came on their own accord. Do you know what I mean? Because I told them about it. I told them where we're going to be, what time we start, and what time we finish. You know, if you want to come, that's where we are. Do you know what I mean? And they came on their own accord. So I didn't have to go and pick them up and take them. And I dropped them home afterwards. But when they came, they weren't even part of the singing. They would just sit in the back. You know, they put the chairs out and everything. And they just sat at the back, just watching and listening. And that just built a stronger relationship. Do you see what I'm saying? Yeah. So when other people say no, when Jesus says yes, nobody can say no. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Wow. And like, you're such an inspiration to so many young men, and you've really tapped into your purpose and your passion. So what advice could you give to a young person that's really struggling to actually find out what they're called to do?
Okay. It's not always easy to find out what you're called to do, but what I would say is not to be afraid of trying new things. Yeah. Be open to trying new things, because you just never know that treasure that's deep within you could be the very thing that you find out when you actually say yes to something that you don't want to do. So when you say, yes, all right, I'll give it a try. I don't really want to do it, but I'll give it a try. And then you find out that you're actually skillful at that thing, better than the person who's teaching you how to do it. Do you know what I mean? So we've all been given gifts. We've all been given gifts and talents, you know, but how do you find that? Which is why I say just be open to everything, but you don't have to attach yourself to everything. You know? So being open to it all, give it a shot. If it's not for you, fine. If it worked out okay, try it again. You know, it's like me and rock climbing. I thought, call me for that. But it was something that I tried, you know, and I really enjoyed it, and I'd do it again. But not, you know, this for me, there's no purpose in climbing rocks. You know, there's no purpose in it at all. My purpose is to impact human beings, you know. Fit, unfit, whatever shape or form they're in, that's my purpose. So I need to look at what have I got. Now, from a very young age, it was my sister that let me know that I've got a voice, I can sing. And I didn't know how well I was able to sing, but it took me some time for that to cultivate, you know. So for any young man that is unsure about what it is that they want to do, if there's anything that they're interested in, I would say just go for it. If it's something that's quite expensive, there's always going to be someone to help them out. We can't be on this on a planet like this and one person can't give that young man £20 to go and sort out what he wants to try. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. I'd say that to all my young people, any young people that I come across, or any adult that I come across. You know, I'm not the richest person in the world. I'm not rich, but I just know that I'm rich in giving things a try. I will give it a try. And I would encourage any young man to just give whatever their interests are in a try. Some young guys would like to be footballers and stuff, and they might be going football club and stuff like that, you know, but they may never be in a football team like they want to be, and because the intentions might not be in the right place. You know? Some guys, when they think about football, firstly, it's money sometimes, and sometimes it could be just the fun of the sport. But when you're actually looking a bit deeper into any kind of sport, music, or whatever profession, for me, it's always, what's the benefit? What will it benefit other people? You know, if I've done something that's benefited me in terms of my own personal growth, then I know that I've got that for a reason, and I've got to share that, you know. So try out a lot of things, and not just sport. You know, I tried barbering. I cut my own hair. Well, when I had hair, the last time someone cut my hair was probably my nephew, actually. It's probably my nephew many moons ago. Yeah. That was probably like 2004. But I used to cut all the guys' hair in my church. Mm-hmm. They come around, pay me like a £10, you know. And then what else? Even buying a house. When I moved to Manchester, I said in the first 10 years, I want to buy a house. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Opportunities came twice, and circumstances at the time, it just didn't happen. But I bought my house in year 9, and I moved in year 10. Mm-hmm. So, and I never ever thought I'd be able to buy a house because, oh gosh, my maths might not be that great. I don't know how to manage this and da 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 da. But I'm thinking those things at a young age. But then when the opportunities came, I thought, see me in my own house. Mm. And the way this house came was like God actually sent it. You know, it's an old council house, but another company came and renovated the whole place. You know, I moved in. Kitchen was already sorted. I didn't have to need to buy anything for the kitchen except my utensils and cutlery. Yeah. Living room floor, the walls were painted, everything was new. Even got solar powered system on the roof. Do you know what I mean?
Wow.
Mm-hmm. In the middle of an area where a lot of people are frightened of, Moss Side. Do you know what I mean? But the whole area's changed. It's renovated. Even they've built some new houses just behind me, you know? Mm. So, I would say to any young man, just be open to everything, but you don't have to attach yourself to everything.
Wow.
That quote came from a gentleman called, I think it's Wayne Dyer, I think his name. And I remember the first time I heard that was about maybe 5 years ago.
Yeah.
And the quote actually is, be open to everything and attached to nothing. Yeah. And it just means that you can hear and listen and take on people's opinions, thoughts, ideas about anything. Even if they say, well, I don't believe in God, you don't have to attach yourself to that.
Yeah.
You can hear them. Well, okay, cool. That's what you do. I don't need to try and convince them. If that's what you think and feel, then if I want it to change or want it to be an influence on your thoughts, then I'll have to show you how that's done. I give you examples of how that's worked for me rather than tell you, no, what do you mean you don't believe in God? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So the whole idea of being open to everything and attached to nothing is like a nice little mantra for me, you know? So I would say that to all young men, be open to everything, because your intuition will tell you what not to attach to,
mm-hmm.
you know? And so follow your heart on that.
Wow. And one thing that just makes me just so inspired by you is, whether it's in your music or whether it's in your life, you always have this energy of hope, and it just comes out so much, like even speaking to you.
Yeah.
So why as believers is it important that we show hope and we show life to others in everything we do?
Okay, so there's a difference between showing hope and showing life.
Yeah.
So showing life is the reality of now, you know, and is showing life is the is being the reality, just being real, you know. Giving someone hope is actually just encouraging someone to stay strong, you know. It's an encouragement. Do you know what I mean? So when you think about that scripture, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So that reality for me works via action. Do you know what I mean? So I feel I have to action some things rather than I hope that works for me. There's a little bit of, you know, doubt in hoping for something sometimes. Do you know what I mean? Depends on the intention, and there's a lot of psychology in that as well. A lot of science in that phrase. And I'm not saying that the Bible's wrong. I'm not saying, you know, I'm not disputing that. I'm just talking about the experiences that we have and that we've been through. So I like the living life bit, you know. I would encourage you guys and other young men, live life. After this lockdown, I would love to travel more. I'd like to see the world a bit more. But yet, I'm kind of afraid and frightened for sitting next to somebody as soon as they start cracking up. You know what I mean? I'm out to go and find my own jet plane and get to some places. But there are things that I'd like to do. My thoughts about the word hope for me has changed slightly. I try not to use it so much, but I try to take action. Things. If there is a thought or a vision for me to do something, go somewhere, speak to someone, even cook something, I'm not thinking, I hope I can do this right. I mean, I'll just crack on with it. And if it comes out right, comes out right. If it doesn't, it doesn't. Therefore, the hope raises a level of expectation. And that's what I've chosen for me not to do, not to raise my expectations too high. I mean, that's not saying that I don't believe in visions or things that I'd like to do in the future or even now. Even with the choir, I wasn't thinking with the choir, oh, I hope this grows. I hope that, you know what I mean? The hope was, I know. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't, oh, I hope people can feel something from this. And it's like, I know people are going to get something from this. I know, because I know what I do, and I know who I am, and I know what I'm about, and I know what I've got. And if I'm going to, I mean, I don't see myself as some big time artist or anything like that, but I'm brilliant at what I do, and I'm glad that I'm brilliant at what I do, and I know what I can get out of people. I feel very confident enough to know what I can pull out of people. That's because other people had pulled that out of me. They weren't saying to me, oh, I hope I can get this out of Wayne, or Wayne, I hope you can do this properly, you know. It weren't that. It's like, get on with it. Karen Gibson's the same. She's like, get on with it. You know what I mean? The same way. So those principles I grew up with. And that's why when folks are like, oh, I don't know if I can do that, I'm like, well, just give it a try. And just see how you get on with it. Even vocal coaching, you know, my students, they're like, oh, that seems really hard. And I'm like, well, let's not sit and analyze. Let's take some action, you know, because that looks really hard. It's saying, oh, I hope I can do that okay. Do you know what I mean? So let's just take action. Feel confident in yourself to take action. Don't be afraid. When we think about, I know it's an old story, when we think about David and Goliath, and I know I've mentioned it already, but he was a young man. Fearless, fighting lions. Do you know what I mean? I'm a Leo. Do you know what I mean? When I see my little beard, like, I'm like a lion, I come out still. But you know, it is, honestly, guys, it is all about just making yourself feel confident, not just feeling confident, but being confident, because we are beings, we are human beings, we are to be a lot of these things that we're kind of like unsure of, uncertain of. You guys setting up these talks, no doubt there wasn't a thought of, oh, I really hope this pulls off, because that speaks fear. You know what I mean? You guys were like, oh, but this can work. We can get this person. We can get that person. If we can't get that person, well, that's cool. No, we'll just go on to another person. Do you know what I mean? You just take an action. And look, you got it up and running. Yeah? Yeah. So what you feel, what you both feel from this talk, and what you take away, is to pass on to the next generation down, if it's the next generation down, or even the next generation above you, because they all need it. Mm. You know, there's not a man on the planet that is perfect, but there is always a man on the planet that's going to need to hear a positive word, and it's not always going to be from me. And they might not want to hear it from me, because my tone of voice might not be the right tone that matches their psyche. It could be your tone, which they hear those frequencies that hits the central nervous system. Makes them, it's just like music. When we hear music, we hear certain chords, it hits us and we're like, do you know what I mean? Mm. So the way that I sing isn't always going to be pleasing to everyone's ears. The way that I speak isn't always going to be pleasing to everyone's ears, but the way that you sing, and you don't have to be some professional singer, it could just be that someone in the world needed a physical being, a human being, to be near them, to even just sing something softly or say something softly, and you guys could be the people for that, you know? But feeling okay with that fact. Mm. Once you know it and believe in yourself about it, yeah, you can create magic.
Yeah. I'm not even going to lie to you. I'm just blown away by this innit.
Wayne Ellington, I salute you. You are amazing. You have made the people behind you so musical that everyone gains. Pussy, I can take the pain.
Are you releasing any music, or is Manchester Inspirational Voices doing any events that people can support? Or
yeah, well, because of the current situation now, everything's quite uncertain. So the only event that we've booked and which still has a question mark is our Christmas concert later on in December. However, what I would, you know, love for people to do is maybe just have a listen to the album. You know, they don't have to love it, they don't have to, you know, say it's, oh, it's the greatest, but I'd like people to, when they hear the album, to listen to it with some openness, you know. Mm. An openness to receive something for themselves within this current situation. Mm. And to maybe pass it on to somebody else, even if it's a song, even if it's a phrase in a song, even if it's like lyrics within a song that stuck out to them, which they can pass those lyrics on to someone else. Anything that's for anyone, I would say, you know, that would be the greatest support to me and to the choir, for someone to just, you know, listen to the songs, man.
Okay, we're rolling. Hi, Wayne. I just want to say thank you. Thank you, thank you. Thank you for producing such a beautiful album, Wayne. You've come such a long way. and I couldn't miss this opportunity to appreciate your work, your craft. Wayne, you know, what's amazing is your love, your time, your dedication, and 100% commitment to making this choir work. You develop them, you coach each and every member of that choir. You know, and I know they love you and you love them. And likewise, you know me, I love you so much. And, you know, thank you. Thank you. My favorite tracks on the album, I've got two at the moment, is the album title itself, Give Us Peace, and Count On Me. The album in general is really good. I think if no one's purchased this, you're missing out. And wherever they perform, whenever they perform, try and be there, because it's such an amazing atmosphere, you know. Wayne, you are God-gifted, and, you know, I love you so much. We tell each other this all the time, but it's nice to have a brother like you. Thank you, Wayne. Thank you. God bless you. Love you always. You know this already. All right. Take care, my love. See you soon. Bye.
Hey, Wayne. Lloyd here. Great to see you. Enjoy all that you do. And this time, it's just to say to you, thank you. Thank you for all that you do, the lives that you've touched. And you know that song I just love when you sing it, for we may never know the people that we've touched, the lives that have been changed. And when you do that, and I really truly thank God for you and all that you do, and you do it with such passion and heart and commitment. You know, you're purposeful in everything that you do, you know, especially concerning MIV. So Wayne, just now and right now, it's just to say to you, thank you. And I pray that everything that God has in store for you, you will receive. You will not lack anything. So God bless you in all your endeavors. Yep, and see you on the next one. Take care.